Ulysses probably needs no introduction. It's a long stream of consciousness novel by the Irish author James Joyce, and it was first published in Paris in 1922. Its elevated status in the canon of literature is more or less a matter of fact nowadays, but it can be difficult to say precisely what makes it so great. For many critics, it's its reproduction in literary form of The Operation of Consciousness, which is a psychological stroke philosophical judgment they may not be qualified to make. For others, it has to do with the novel's reimagining of the mythical wanderings of Odysseus. But that's a strange basis for an encomium. More often, it's its originality. But what is originality? And doesn't it have bad as well as good forms? The problem is compounded by the fact that for all Joyce's alleged genius for language, it's rare to hear anyone actually quote Ulysses. And it's rarely appealed to in discussions of literary worth, and it's rarely compared to other novels. Why is it greater than, say, Ford Madox Ford's Parade's End or D.H. Lawrence's Women in Love? To answer that question, one probably needs to put oneself in the shoes of an up-and-coming novelist in the years just before World War I. You've written a few short stories, and important people are looking forward to your first novel. You're eager to begin. But of course, all works of art are to some extent developments of the past achievements of others. Who are your most celebrated predecessors? Well, perhaps Dickens, Eliot, Edith Wharton, Somerset Maugham. Obviously, however, they're all doing roughly the same thing, extended tales of complex characters in challenging situations with one authorial eye on the social background. It might occur to you that depressingly, it's probably a matter of diminishing returns. Then someone gives you Ulysses, and they tell you it's already being hailed as a masterpiece. I think your first reaction would be shock, possibly even indignation. But assuming you were open-minded enough, it could only ultimately look like a liberation. Either way, however, the implications are clear. From now on, you can do whatever you want. Indeed, you'll have to, because your fellow writers definitely will be. Of course, that wouldn't be possible if Ulysses had been merely a stream of consciousness novel, because the action, such as it is, takes place in a city over the course of an entire day. Everything's in there, high and low, sacred and profane, genteel and vulgar. And it's a highly learned book. And it's funny. And that replication of the wanderings of Odysseus, well, it's really a two fingers up to the literary canon. All novelists need a great subject. Previously, the greatest novels had focused on an injustice or unfairness of some kind. By contrast, Joyce's great subject is life itself. That might strike some people as a backward step. It's why Virginia Woolf's 1925 Mrs. Dalloway, often considered to be a response to Ulysses, may in some ways be an enhancement of it. It reintroduces questions of social justice. How far the tools of modernism were suited to dealing with such questions, or whether the older traditional storytelling techniques did it better, is still an open question. Ulysses probably needs no introduction. It's a long stream of consciousness novel by the Irish author James Joyce, and it was first published in Paris in 1922. Its elevated status in the canon of literature is more or less a matter of fact nowadays, but it can be difficult to say precisely what makes it so great. For many critics, it's its reproduction in literary form of The Operation of Consciousness, which is a psychological stroke philosophical judgment they may not be qualified to make. For others, it has to do with the novel's reimagining of the mythical wanderings of Odysseus. But that's a strange basis for an encomium. More often, it's its originality. But what is originality? And doesn't it have bad as well as good forms? The problem is compounded by the fact that for all Joyce's alleged genius for language, it's rare to hear anyone actually quote Ulysses. And it's rarely appealed to in discussions of literary worth, and it's rarely compared to other novels. Why is it greater than, say, Ford Madox Ford's Parade's End or D.H. Lawrence's Women in Love? To answer that question, one probably needs to put oneself in the shoes of an up-and-coming novelist in the years just before World War I. You've written a few short stories, and important people are looking forward to your first novel. You're eager to begin. But of course, all works of art are to some extent developments of the past achievements of others. Who are your most celebrated predecessors? Well, perhaps Dickens, Eliot, Edith Wharton, Somerset Maugham. Obviously, however, they're all doing roughly the same thing, extended tales of complex characters in challenging situations with one authorial eye on the social background. It might occur to you that, depressingly, it's probably a matter of diminishing returns. Then someone gives you Ulysses, and they tell you it's already being hailed as a masterpiece. I think your first reaction would be shock, possibly even indignation. But assuming you were open-minded enough, it could only ultimately look like a liberation. Either way, however, the implications are clear. From now on, you can do whatever you want. Indeed, you'll have to, because your fellow writers definitely will be. Of course, that wouldn't be possible if Ulysses had been merely a stream of consciousness novel, because the action, such as it is, takes place in a city over the course of an entire day. Everything's in there, high and low, sacred and profane, genteel and vulgar. And it's a highly learned book. And it's funny. And that replication of The Wanderings of Odysseus, well, it's really a two fingers up to the literary canon. All novelists need a great subject. Previously, the greatest novels had focused on an injustice or unfairness of some kind. By contrast, Joyce's great subject is life itself. That might strike some people as a backward step. It's why Virginia Woolf's 1925 Mrs. Dalloway, often considered to be a response to Ulysses, may in some ways be an enhancement of it. It reintroduces questions of social justice. How far the tools of modernism were suited to dealing with such questions, or whether the older traditional storytelling techniques did it better, is still an open question.